Welcome. This is the third Saori Arts NYC artist talk. We're very grateful that all of you were able to come today, and we are very happy that so many of you made contributions. We're very appreciative of all the donations, and the proceeds will be used solely to fund our programming. Just so you know, the meeting today is being recorded. All who registered will receive a link to a closed caption recording, which will also be freely available on our website. You can activate the live transcription at the lower right-hand corner of your Zoom screen. During screen share, if you wish to see details of the artist's work, click on the View Option button in the middle of the top bar, and you'll be able to zoom in. Please type questions and comments into the chat or the Q&A. These will be answered at the end. Please mute yourself during the talk. Saori Arts NYC is a nonprofit organization whose mission is to inspire creativity, joy, and self-confidence through freestyle hand weaving for people of all ages with disabilities or chronic illness. The Saori philosophy envisions that each of us has a unique sensibility and the power to create. This uncomplicated weaving style has no predetermined rules or expectations, freeing individuals to explore, invent, and challenge themselves. Imperfections can be celebrated as unexpected beauty. This simple technique allows anyone, no matter their physical or mental challenges, to explore the visual, tactile, and rhythmical sensations of weaving. The weavers with whom we work are empowered to make their own choices of color, texture, and design. The resulting creation reflects the uniqueness of the weaver. Today, we are delighted to have two artists whose work reflect the spirit of Saori. Juliet Martin and Batyah, welcome. I met Juliet at Loop of the Loom, a Saori weaving studio, about 5 years ago, and has always been a fan of her work. She's a Brooklyn-based artist who makes fiber memoir sculptures that combine hand-woven fabrics that have been cut up and reassembled with drawing words and machine-made fabrics and embroidery. Her work reflects her personal experience with humor, irony, and satire. She pairs everyday objects with unsettling concepts, challenging the viewer. Yahel Batyah is an Israeli-based Saori artist and instructor who also trained briefly at Loop of the Loom. Her artistic practice combines sculpture, performance, prose, and poetry. She's the founder of Studio Teferet, Ayatsara, where she shares her creativity, art, and experience with other weavers. Rooted in the Saori philosophy and her own experience with disability, Yahel advocates for fully accessible workshops, equipment, and studio. This talk will last an hour. Juliet will first present her work, followed by Yahel. They will then have a conversation about their art and Saori weaving experiences. This will be followed by a Q&A. After the hour, for those who wish to join us, there will be another 30 minutes for questions, conversation, community, and engagement. Juliet.
So I'm Juliet Martin, and I am a Saori weaver. About 9 years ago, I went to Loop of the Loom, the Saori studio in Manhattan, and I walked in, and it was like a hug. Everyone was so welcoming and so friendly. It wasn't competitive, which is unusual for an art community. It really made me feel at home. And they set me up on my black warp, as everyone starts with, and said, no rules, no mistakes. And I thought, oh no, no rules, no mistakes. What am I gonna do? So I actually created a little structure for myself. I didn't wind any bobbins. I only used ones that were already prepared. Also, all the materials that I used were recycled. Nothing was new. And so I created the piece that you see on the right, and I still have it on my wall, the first piece I did. I started to create my own style, figuring out the direction I wanted to go. On the left is a piece from a collection called Men I've Known. I created these phallic structures to point out the inequities in how women see men and how men see women. My mom had a funny comment. Someone asked her why I did so many things about sex, and she said, well, do what you know. So the next group I did was called Voices in My Head. I took all the color out of the piece. with the intention of highlighting the texture and the silhouette. The next group I did was called I Would Wear That. When I was in the studio, people would come over and say, oh, is that a scarf? And I'd say, no, it's a sculpture. And they'd say, well, it could be a scarf. And I'd say, no, it's a sculpture. And so eventually I named the collection I Would Wear That. I cut out pieces of cardboard, stretched metallic fabric over them, and then overlaid Saori weavings with holes inside them. The next group I did was called My Eyes Are Down Here. Again, addressing issues of gender inequality, I created this time female forms that had eyes on their bodies, on their breasts. I also hung them on coat racks, on coat hangers, with the idea that they were costumes that can be put on and taken off. From there, I started including drawing into my sculptures. This was new for me and very exciting. On the lower right, you can see a little self-portrait. I get car sick really easily. So this is me puking as I drive along. So one day I went to the studio right before starting this collection, set up my warp. You can see my little orange highlights. That's something that I always like to do. And I chose my colors and I started weaving. I didn't know what I was going to do. I didn't know where I was going. And I started to create these bulbous forms, which cascaded down the tapestry, undulating in and out, creating a sense of motion. What's really important for me to point out right now is with all of my Saori weavings, my emotions come out. It is very hard to create a Saori weaving that doesn't have to do with feeling or outpour. So I looked at this and tried to figure out what was I feeling. And I decided it really felt like falling in love, but I wanted to add illustration. Years ago, I did digital illustration with drawings and the computer, and I use those same techniques now. On the left, you can see my little self-portrait, my hair hanging down, my limbs flailing. In the center, you can see little circles. I use these for the background. This way, the illustration in the end looks more handmade than computer made. I consider the computer to be a tool and the drawing to be the product. So you can see on the right, there's the orange circle background along with the figure falling down. I drew about four figures and repeated them over and over. I printed them on fabric, which you can do from any inkjet printer. I changed the colors around. You can see the black background with the white figure. You can see the yellow background with the black figure. All of the figures have holes in their stomach. I like to think of it as a pit in your stomach. And so I did an embroidery line down the vertical aspect of the piece, connecting all of the holes, sort of like a lifeline. I then took fabric and sewed it onto the tapestry like a sleeping bag. But before I closed it off, I made little pillows. I like using fabric for what it can do, and pillows are the perfect way. It adds a little bit of motion and a little bit of three-dimensionality to the pieces. In the end, there were five, and it was called How It Feels Falling For You Again and Again and Again. The next collection I did was called You Don't Look Crazy. When I was 18, I was diagnosed with bipolar disorder, and I suffered from extreme mood swings for about 25 years. Then my medications were figured out, and I was, quote, normal. And people I just met would say, you don't look crazy. And I'm like, is this a compliment? Is this an insult? So I wanted to create a body of work that reflect those questions. I wanted to convey to people who don't suffer from mental illness what it feels like. And I wanted for people who do to not feel alone. I decided to communicate through drawing again. And this way I created a bunch of symbols. Symbols that could be rearranged in any way to communicate a message. For me, my moods, when they're at their worst, are called mixed state. And what that means is that you have mania and depression at the same time. So with these little icons to convey that, I combine different ideas. On the bottom, there's a daisy, and then it has blood flowing out of it. On the top, there's a light bulb with vampire fangs. Before, with the How It Feels Falling For You collection, I made a lot of dolls, and I was surprised because people loved them. They could really relate. They felt like toys. They felt serious. So I wanted to use that way of communication with these as well. So I made these little frantic dolls with the emojis on their bellies, on their heads. On the right is one that I created to represent the day before I got married. The day before I got married, I was the first time, the day before I got married, the night before was manic, I was depressed. I actually had electroconvulsive therapy. So I call this too manic to marry. This is called overdose. I'm gonna start you here and then we'll go back and construct the entire piece. I want to convey and say again that Saori weaving is emotional. It's almost impossible to not be emotional. When I chose the colors for this, the tans, the reds, the blues, they felt frantic. They felt uncomfortable. This was the first group of sculptures that I incorporated text into the mix. On the left, you can see one of the pieces where the fabric I used to write all the text upon. This is boring, this is hard, this sucks, this is sad. If you're far away from the piece, it looks like a texture. It doesn't look like written word. But when you get closer, you can see it and you can read it. And it acts almost as a cliff note. Like if you didn't know what you were seeing, now you do. And so I put that into the skull as a filler, almost like an upholstery. Here's one of the emojis I made for overdose. Naturally, a bottle of poison. So I took these bottles of poison and this time I turned them into pillows, again, using what fabric can do. So I made these tiny pillows and hung them like Christmas ornaments from the top of the piece. I hate, hate, hate the phrase drawing with yarn, but I don't know how else to describe it. This is yarn that I spun and I dyed, and then to create a sense of motion on the overdose piece, I sewed it in different patterns around the tapestry. You can see another little poison bottle, but this time it's stitched onto the fabric with heavy, heavy stitches. So here again is that piece. It's confusing, it's depressing. The tassels are there to so you can feel how desperate it feels. There's barbed wire. The next collection I did was called Something Looks Wrong. Those eyes, love the eyes. These eyes look at you, they look away, they look weak, they look strong, they are self-protecting, they are accusatory. Over the next few months, I drew over 250 bodies. They were all the same and all different. They were all long and lanky. They did not have eyes. They barely had features. There's the rib cage, there's the profile. So, you know, no one had arms. Everything was sort of desperate. They were sort of standing there alone. So I took the original eyes and imprinted them on each of the figures. Now all of a sudden they're strong. Now all of a sudden they act as a group, and they stand visually. It's sort of an unusual combination for me. So I took the Saori weaving and tried a little bit of a switch. Again, I drew with yarn, but this time, after creating all these paths, I filled them in with paint. You can see the purple strip down the middle, the brown, and then the white circle on the upper right. But there was more. I also cut out pieces of the tapestry to create an unusual silhouette. Here's another one of the pieces. Again, the Saori yarn is important. It's really loaded and I really like that. I also incorporated some burlap sort of to give another dimension. So here are those three pieces finished. You can see, as I pointed out, they all have different silhouettes, which sort of activates the piece itself. They're all about 2 feet high. The smaller one is about a foot, so they range. Here's the final collection. It's about 12 feet in height. We started hanging it from the bottom and went up with the idea that we wouldn't run out of room. First, we hung the large pieces, and then we tucked the small ones into the crevices. And here we have all these women. The eyes empower them. They also protect them. They're part of a group, but they're individual. The next group I did was called Household Objects Remind Me of You. About a year and a half ago, I noticed I was drawing pots and pans and chairs and tables, which was unusual for me because I usually dealt with people and animals. At the same time, COVID was happening. And when my husband would take out the trash, if he didn't come back right away, I became scared to death that I would be alone. What if he passed away? What would that mean? I didn't have my friends and I didn't have my family. And that's when I realized I was using these objects as my lifeline. Here's a chair that I love, and here's a lamp. The lamp really speaks to me, and I used it over and over again. Here's the final piece. On the left is the Saori weaving, and on the right, some machine-made fabric. By putting them together, it really accents both of them and points out the strengths and the differences between them. In this chair, I also use text, but this time I actually created a narrative. One of the things it says is, when I look around my apartment, I think all about the times we sat together, our hands barely touching. So now, it wasn't a collage, it was an actual story. And again, from far away, it looked like upholstery. From close up, there was a story. I had an unusual problem though. A curator said to me, "I am so sorry for your loss. I can't believe you went through that." And I'm like, oh man, I can't believe this. So I had to fess up that I didn't go through it and that it wasn't happening. And it was about loss, not loss itself. Here's another piece. Again, handmade fabric, machine-made fabric, empty, empty, empty chairs. I don't know if I will ever forget the last time I saw you. The last group of pieces I made for that collection, I incorporated these cutout forms. They added dimension to the piece that wasn't there. I also drew grids and painted them in. I'm going to show you a video I made. The sound isn't great, but there are subtitles.
Hi, I'm a beaver. Here I am setting up the work. I look bored. That's because setting up the work, it's the worst. Choosing yarn is the best. Everyone loves choosing yarn. I'm the fastest beaver in the entire world. I'm making safety pins out of cardboard. I draw them, I cut them, I tape them, I paint them, I paint them, I draw, and then I have safety pins. Look at me so. Look at my artist assistant. We work really well together. I'm taking the yarn I chose and sewing it on the tapestry. I'm using the yarn to create an irregular grid. Next, I paint in some of the squares. Before and after. In order to get the text I want, I write everything over and over. Then I put it on the computer and write some more. Time to arrange the safety pins. It's good to have an assistant at times like these. This is not good. This is not good. this is definitely not good. Yay!
So now I'm on to my newest collection. I'm just going to give you a small taste. It's called You Make Me Uncomfortable, and it has to do with the fact that I so often feel uncomfortable in my own skin. Here we have puppies and kittens with thumbs. Here we have me with a mohawk and chicken legs. Here we have a human hand with chicken legs and flowers, because flowers go with chicken legs. But so that's me. Maureen, I'm all done, or Yael, if you wanna start up, but thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, hi, I'm Yael. I've been weaving Saori since just before my youngest son was born. I discovered Saori when I was looking for Japanese sewing patterns. I used to be a spinner. I used to really like doing handwork, learning to spin on a drop spindle, learning to dye my own wool. And I found it very, very challenging to move beyond it as a hobby and a craft. So when I discovered Saori, I saw that it was an opportunity for me to translate the material that I was creating, the raw material, and create it into something else. So the first picture you see here on the slide is the very, very first piece I made, with every single piece of hand-woven, hand-spun yarn that I made. I actually wove this with a pre-wound warp that I had ordered, but I did not use the Saori loom. I tried to, in my enthusiasm, to squeeze 350 threads onto a very small cable loom. It was met with a lot of frustration, and you will see actually in the centerpiece and on the left side, you'll see how tightly you squeeze the salvage edges are. So this was my ambitious beginning of Saori weaving. The other motivation for my journey in Saori is just between the time when I had just started that first piece and the birth of my son, my best friend, Sean Esther, passed away from cancer. I didn't have a chance to say goodbye to her. She was living in Canada at the time, and her state of health had deteriorated very, very quickly. I had decided that in my sense of loss and grief that I wanted to do something in her memory, which was to create a cover for a Torah scroll. Traditionally, we would dedicate a Torah scroll in somebody's memory, not immediately right away, but over time. And Sharon always supported me in my handwork and in the arts and crafts. She herself was an occupational therapist and was always there to help and support me as somebody that was striving to be an artist and also having a physical disability. What I had decided to do was to purchase a pre-wound warp from Saori and also my first loom. And that later that, the following summer, I had gone back to Canada to visit my family and to meet with her family. And I requested permission from her husband and daughter to use her headscarves in the making of this piece of material I wanted to do. So the picture here shows the color scheme that I had to work with. I had envisioned a completely different direction. And this is the first lesson that I learned with Saori, is that we have to go with the flow. You know, my vision of an all white on white textile garment, a piece turned into a more dynamic piece. So what I ended up doing is taking pieces of her headscarf and tearing them and inserting them into the material. So on the left, you'll see a close-up of some of the work coming out. I wanted to originally do some more details in terms of creating an image of a tree. But my personal experience and my skill level was not up to par. So what I ended up doing is reaching out to other textile artists and using her watercolor that she had made previously of a tree, I had another textile artist create an embroidered piece. I don't have the image here today because it's not related to my personal work. After I'd finished that textile, my friend Sean had a son that was the same age as my daughter. We also had a really good friend in Toronto that had, their family had moved to Israel and they were a guest in my home. When I explained to them the project that I'd done with Sharon's headscarves and creating textiles of memory, that's sort of the term I started using, they were really excited and they had asked me to create a set of bags to hold two ritual objects. One was the phylacteries, a tefillin, and the other one would be a telly for their son who was about to become a bar mitzvah. So the textile that they gave me were in fact from four generations, the father, the grandfather, and the great-grandfather, their own personal ritual garments that they had from Russia and Poland and Lithuania. I had deconstructed every single piece, including the embroidery, including the seam thread and the zippers, and I used them to create the new material. So on the left side, you'll see the finished objects. I took the original velvet of some of the older bags and I had them embroidered professionally. And on the right-hand side, you'll see what the warp looked at, like toward the end of the project. From that project, I still had quite a few meters of warp left and I decided I just wanted to work and play with color. I had no intention whatsoever. This was a completely change in direction for myself. What I really wanted to do is let go 100%, not focus on direction, not focus on meaning, just a complete blank narrative and go with it. I created this next piece at a very significant time in my life where I was trying to figure out my own personal direction. What ended up happening is I created a textile that elicited a lot of responses from people. When I started posting it on social media and on Facebook, I just had a lot of people asking me like, what are you planning to do with this? Where is it going? Can I buy it? What's it for? And I decided I wasn't going to sell it. For me, it was a very meaningful garment. I didn't have the heart to cut my fabric and I just let it sit. So you'll see, I worked with my friend Sephora. She helped me with taking pictures to get more detail about the range of color that came out of this project. I myself can't describe any more than what you actually see. I literally just spent 4 hours in my studio from one night to the next day, just working and weaving and just playing with the color with no intention and no design, but this is what came out of it. The next phase that I went through is the idea of working with the colors of royalty. I am a religious Jew living in Israel, and one aspect of living here is reading their weekly portion of the Torah. And in one particular portion, it's called Truma. It describes in it the clothing of the high priest and the color that I used. So I delved into that a lot, and a lot of the colors that were described in the text, I sought out and I either dyed it myself, or I ordered it, and I used it in creating warps in this color scheme. So you'll see that the colors range from Bordeaux, indigo, navy, dark purple, deep purple, and there's also elements of gold and silk or white colors. This particular fabric itself created, again, a lot of feedback for me. I'm not very, very active on social media. I don't have Instagram, just use Facebook. But out of this project came two families that immediately responded to the material that I created. And one woman in particular decided that she wanted to gift this to her husband, again, asking me to create two bags to hold the ritual objects that her husband uses on a daily basis, one for his tefillin and one for his tallit. I had met with them for the first time, and I introduced their daughters to hand spinning, the daughter and the son. And so you'll see on the right-hand side with the hand spindle, you'll see the small bits of thread that the kids did manage to spin, and we did it together as a project. And I subsequently wove it into their father's cloth that was eventually sewn into a set of tallit and tefillin bags for him. With the drastic responses that I received from the earlier log textile, and everyone was asking me if they could buy it, if they could have it, what am I going to do with it? I decided that I was going to recreate it, but instead of using the same warp colors, I was going to do the opposite. I was going to take an ombre color scheme, ranging again from Bordeaux to purple to blue, and recreate a warp and create a series of textiles reflecting their colors. As I got to the end of the color spectrum towards the dark blues, I became very, very interested in the color indigo. And I have a very good friend that teaches indigo dye in classes. And I spent the day with her learning how to create a vat and to create my own indigo dye warp. I have a lot of interest in numbers and Fibonacci numbers. So what I did is when I created this white warp, I tied the warp together in spaces that were equidistant according to the golden mean. So this is why you'll see on the longer spectrum of the of this piece that you'll see it spaced out pretty much in proportion of the golden mean, which is 1.61. So the last thing is I consider myself primarily a Saori teacher and guide. I did study at Serendipity Studio in upstate New York, and I also worked and studied at Loop of the Loom. Prior to those actual placements, I actually had to learn on my own. I had ordered the book Self-Innovation Through Weaving from Saori in Japan, and I spent a year studying the book. Living in Israel, it's very, very lonely being the only Saori weaver here in the beginning. Over time, through social media, I discovered other Saori weavers, and I was happy to connect to other women and other artists that had learned either directly from Misao Jo or have themselves grew up in Japan and learned Saori there. What I strive to create in all my workshops is a sense of belonging, a sense of peace, a sense of calm and expressing, and especially that everyone can weave. I hear a lot of students tell me that, oh, I can't do this. This is difficult for me. I'll never be able to do it. I'm not an artist, I'm not creative. And the first thing I tell them is come, sit down and try. I really feel it's important that Saori studios are accessible 100%. That means that anyone should be able to walk or wheel or be pushed into a Saori studio and be able to read. There should also be adaptive equipment available in every studio. And I feel that there should be at least one or two instructors that are very familiar with ways being innovative on how to adapt certain techniques for people that have low dexterity or low vision. And the other important thing to remember is communication. I personally have been diagnosed as having a hearing loss since I was 3 years old. Over my years, I've learned to lip read, I've learned to adapt. And living in Israel, where I'm not fluent in Hebrew, I've learned to teach this workshop in a language that's not my mother tongue. I've also learned to teach to people that don't always understand what I'm saying because it's very difficult for me to enunciate words in Hebrew. But I've learned to create a system and a method of teaching and giving over Saori in a way that is accessible beyond language barriers. So I feel that if we're going to move forward as a community, I think the most important thing to remember is that we always have to be aware and to check in with other students and teachers and other people in the community. What can we do to bring you closer? How can we accommodate you? If you feel that there is a barrier, what can we do to help alleviate that? So I'm going to switch into talk a little bit about my influences and the different creative processes that I've had. When I first arrived in New York, I came with a loom with a warp that I had already made in Israel. If you look at this picture here, on the right-hand side, you'll see exactly what the warp was intended to be, which is supposed to be a simple brown alpaca shawl with silk and organic merino. Now, through the wonderful teacher at Loop of the Loom, I was encouraged to be more expressive and to break outside of my very narrow way of thinking. Even though I had learned to express myself the Saori way, there was still so much more to do. So the second piece, also from the same warp, you see how I started to let go a little bit more. And again, I started switching up the colors, switching up the warp. And then the third piece, that's when I started putting holes in it. That's when I started adding structured color. And it was really a big move away from being comfortable in a very a closed way. The final piece, you'll see in here. So you'll see how I really strive to just go all out. I created holes, I wrapped the warp thread together, I mixed up the colors, and I really did a lot of contrasting. And then the final piece, again, I threw caution to the wind out the door. And I just started grabbing colors off the yarn wall. And again, just going with the flow and really switching things up. And you'll see, again, I explored with using texture and shadow weaving, adding more geometric designs, adding a lot more texture, bringing out the ribbons and making more loops, making more holes, floating weft. A lot of spacing, alternating my, the beat and the how tight that I was weaving and how loose I was weaving. And again, it's just this whole progression of me finally letting go and finally getting out of a very narrow box that I had created for myself, even though I hadn't done it intentionally. The final project that I was asked to do in New York was to create my own work. And this is the day that I started making this was also the first day I got to meet Juliet. Juliet was working on a very dynamic piece and I really admired her from a distance and I was very shy and hesitant, but I was happy to, you know, to introduce myself and say hi and get very like fangirl. So with this piece, it was really about love and loss. And I created this piece with the intention knowing that you know, the element that was bringing me to New York and the element of me coming to learn at Loop of the Loom, I was probably never going to be able to come back there again. So this was a eulogy for, you know, an experience that I had and was having at that time in New York and that was going to be ending very soon. I created a lot of texture in this piece. I really worked with different threads and different textures and facing. I also, again, I really spent a lot of time when I do work, I like to take progress photography. And oftentimes I change it up so that I'm taking pictures in black and white just to capture that emotion that I'm feeling in the moment. Other element of this piece required me to ply up to four colors together. As I had mentioned before, I have a lot of connection to the biblical description of the clothing of the high priest and the description of how the threads and the materials were made. So I tried to reproduce that in my work as well. again, combining the colors and the texture together to reflect some of that sense of holiness that I felt really connected to. I really focused a lot on texture and creating loops and creating three dimension in my work. The other thing is I predominantly use a lot of black, but the thing is a lot of the threads that we use in this piece are very reflective. You'll see that they're over here in the red, there are bits of sequins that are popping out from the warp threads that I chose. Again, you'll see this progression of colors ranging from bordeaux to red to green to blues to purple and to aquamarine as well. As I got toward the end, I really wanted to add a sort of like a finale, which was the hanging threads and the blue ribbons that really reflected sort of that finality of that I'm now at the end of one ocean, that I'm here in New York on the East Coast, and soon I'll be heading back to the Middle East and to the Mediterranean. And this too was sort of like the final piece, the final step. And again, I've left it predominantly unfinished with no twisting of the fringes, leaving sort of everything unspoken, sort of a lot of loose ends, basically. And again, you'll see the piece as a whole, as it was intended to be displayed, which is to be stretched out against the wall, but with backlighting, because I wanted people to see that this was not just about the colors on the surface, but also the black fire and white fire, which is often used to describe the Torah, that the Torah is actually black fire written on white fire. And I wanted to express that by having it backlit and stretched out, so you can actually see the shading, the shadow that's cast through the piece. Maureen, do you have a time for one more, or are we done?
I think it might be nice for you and Juliet to have your conversation now.
Okay, that's great.
Hi. So I have to say, Jill, I remember meeting you too. I was there and you were there, and I'm like, who is this woman with this positive energy? She is so great. And I think we had a joke about lingerie,
yes, or something. Exactly. We had this joke that you were working on a piece and it was like bright pink, and you said it's about death, and I'm like, oh, okay. And I had this like dark black piece, and you asked me like, what joy is about? And I'm like, about love. Like, it was almost like we were doing like opposites.
It was so funny. And we also ran into each other. Well, we became fast friends, and then we had another coincidence. Was I did an artist in residency at Mass MoCA. And there was a woman there who was just learning weaving. And I said to her, when you come back to New York, I'm going to teach you Saori weaving. And then like, I didn't hear from her for 2 years until she was working with Jel in Israel. And So, I wanted to ask you if you could talk about teaching mistakes and the difference between intentional mistakes and mistakes.
Okay, so the first thing I tell people when they walk into my studio and they sit down, and I present it to them as there's two ways of doing this. The idea is that I want to reassure you there's no such thing as mistakes. You don't have to worry about perfection. You don't have to worry about things being, you know, done a certain way. But there's other types of mistakes that impede the function of our weaving. So for example, if the warp is not put on properly, it impedes the function of the shaft going up and down. So I talk about the technical mistakes, which oftentimes when it impedes us, and then I talk about the emotional mistakes, and I talk about the technique. And really, the hardest people to teach are traditional weavers, the ones that come with experience, because they kept saying, oh no, it has to be like this. I'm like, no, it's okay. The easier people to teach are the ones, kids that have never done this before. and also families where they're looking to do something like a bonding experience. What I really, really enjoy doing is just telling people, okay, just pick a color and go with it. I find a lot of people get obsessed with, you know, what, how many colors? I'm like, no, just pick one. And I just get people going, sit down. Oftentimes I say like, you know what, it's fine. They'll ask me, oh, is this okay? What happened here? And I try to tell them, switch your feet and move forward and try again. And I think in the course of the two and a half hours that they are with me, I think I've ingrained in them this philosophy for life, that when we are meeting up with an obstacle or some kind of impediment, I just tell people, you know, switch your feet, switch directions, just do something different and move forward and try again, because that's all you can do.
I have a friend who has a studio, and she has said the same thing about traditional weavers, in terms, not to badmouth them, but they have a hard time moving over to the no mistakes.
So I wanted to ask you a question. What was the worst advice and best advice you've gotten in art or life?
So I would say it was almost the worst reaction, which was meant to be advice. I was doing ceramics in Singapore, and I was being mentored by one of the top Southeast Asian ceramicists. And he had me do, you know, 100 mugs exactly the same. It was very Karate Kid. And he was so strict. And I made my mugs, and then he's like, all right, now you can decorate it. And I brought over my decorated mug, and he said, this is not art. You are not an artist. Go back. And that was like the worst advice I've ever gotten. It totally destroyed me. And then in the end, the only positive thing he ever said to me was like, you have potential. And I was like, I have potential. So that was really rough. And actually, that's sort of like why I like the Saori weaving so much, is like, you're not making 100 weavings that are exactly the same.
Right.
How about you?
Okay, so I was one. Okay, I think the worst advice that was ever told me was I should go to university, when I very much wanted to be in a college-specific program, a very technical program. The professor of that program told me, what are you doing here? Your marks are so high, you should go to university. University is not for me. I needed a shorter time, like a shorter focused educational directive, but that's in the past. And in terms of art, some of the worst advice I was given was, oh, you should sell this, which sort of reminds me of the piece that you did, like, oh, I would wear that. You know, sometimes you just want to create for the sake of creating, and someone will call me and say, oh, can you make me a tablecloth? Can you make me this? Can you make me that? And I'm like, I got to the point where I just told people, no, but you're welcome to come to the studio and make it yourself. And then they actually would understand what is involved in making something like this.
I feel like some of the best advice was almost the no advice, motivation. When I met Yukako, for those of you who don't know, she's the one who runs the Saori studio in Manhattan, and she was the one who trained me. And I almost feel like the word train is deceiving, in that what I really appreciated about the training was very, very little technical stuff. Like, that was very secondary. And it was so much more about the philosophy. And for me, that really impacted the kind of work I did and the direction that I went in. So
I felt the same way. I think by being at Loop of the Loom, I was given like an open palette. And also, like you were telling before, about learning about the philosophy and the discipline, like every morning I was coming in to help open up the studio and prepare. And I had to make a lot of changes for myself internally. For someone that had a physical disability, for someone that also had ADHD, having to be very, very structured was very, very challenging for me. Despite it being a very open and welcoming atmosphere, it does require a certain sense of discipline from a certain level. And I think for me in the beginning, I felt really intimidated. I felt like, maybe there isn't a space for me in the Saori community as an artist and an instructor that has a disability. But I've learned over the years that's not the case, that, you know, we don't need to be on a higher level than anyone else, that we need to, and this is what, if you delve back into the original thoughts and words of Ms. Zhao, is that we learn from everyone, that our teachers are our students and our students are our teachers, and that we can learn from everyone and everything surrounding us. And we just have to open our eyes to that. And, you know, there's always all these opportunities.
I absolutely agree. And I think, you know, I mentioned this earlier, like the lack of competitiveness is huge. And that was actually probably for me the hardest thing to get past. And I still have it, but it's less than it was. You know, I did the Ivy League school. I did the top art school. I did, you know, web design. I was the best. And like to come in and like.
Now you know how I feel being in conversation with you. I'm having to write my biography and I'm like, I didn't do anything related to art. And I'm expected to be in conversation with you, okay?
Well,
there you go.
There you go.
You win.
So I'm curious about cultural differences with regard to teaching in Israel as compared to teaching in the United States. Do you feel like there were sort of different ways of expressing the same thing?
Yeah, there were. I think the original impetus of why I chose to go to New York, because I needed to see a fully operational studio that was reflective of the population that I am, you know, teaching. Israel's population is about 9 million people, and the greater Manhattan area is also around that same number. So I wanted to see what the studio looked like and the types of people that were coming in and how something could function. Because what was happening to me is that I didn't have one studio that people were coming to me, because I live up in the periphery. I live in a very rural area, and I was outside of an Anglo or English speaking bubble. So my target student base was not even close to me. And what I discovered is that there isn't a difference. What I had to do is I had to go out to people. So rather than being one location that people were coming in, like it was in New York, I was having to go out and travel. So I was like literally a nomadic studio and a nomadic teacher, which became very, very exhausting. But out of that, I met a lot of people. I was doing workshop in public at the train station in Jerusalem. I was working at an English speaking, center for retirees. In Jerusalem, I went to Netanya. I was invited by the Japanese Israeli Cultural Association for 2 years in a row to present at the Town of Batyah Festival. So what I found is that in terms of expression, it's the same. I think internationally, everyone creates their own sense of who they are by themselves and it expresses themselves on the loom. And it doesn't matter where that is.
Great. Well, thank you. This has been just fascinating and wonderful. You guys are two just amazing artists. I have been monitoring the chat, and I haven't seen any questions. So if someone has a question, I presume my colleagues are looking at the Q&A. It's been really interesting to hear how emotions come out in the weaving that you guys, both of you do. I mean, I find the same thing as a Saori weaver, that you go there and you're just beginning to explore. How do you encourage people, Yahel, in your studio? I know you get them started, you say choose a color, but you know, with Saori, you guide, you don't teach someone, you just sort of open it up for them.
So the way I approach it is, recently, most of my workshops have been family collaborative weaving workshops. So I generally, and I've been inviting people into my home. So my living room gets turned into the studio, and all the looms come out, and I, you know, put the treasure out, I put the, you know, the bobbins out, everything is out for them. I don't have a yarn wall yet, but we'll get into that. And what happens is I just get started right away. And I asked people, I passed around the basket that had the pre-wound bobbins. I said, pick a color, pick the first color that speaks to you. All right, this is how we, you know, open up the shuttle. This is the pin. This is how, like, it's literally, it's very, very hands-on. And I do very minimal talking. It's very one word explanation, especially when I'm switching between languages. Oftentimes I become very stuttery because I forget the words I'm trying to say. But because I'm doing things physically and people can see what I'm doing, I rely more on body language than actual words.
Okay.
And then I just have people sit and go, and they go for
it. Okay. We do have a couple of questions. One of us, someone has asked if you can do Saori weaving and not on a conventional Saori loom.
But that's the question. That's the question. Which side of the argument do you want to take, Gail?
You can take it.
I have heard both things. I have heard people say Saori weaving is on a Saori loom. I've heard people say Saori is a philosophy. But then, of course, the question comes, if it's a philosophy, does that mean when I write something on my typewriter, but I'm practicing the Saori philosophy, does that make it Saori?
Right. Yes, so, I mean, so it's an interesting, because it's the one thing that we've struggled with this last year of the pandemic, because obviously we can't use our Saori looms.
Right.
So we've been using paper plates and pieces of cardboard and teaching people to weave on those, but with a Saori style, you know, no rules. These are some guidelines, but you do what you want to do. Somebody has asked Juliet, what kind of paints do you use on your fabric?
I use jacquard fabric paints. You can get them from Dharma Trading, and they are different than acrylics in that acrylics, I do use them sometimes. Acrylics sit on top and fiber paint soaks into, it's not a dye, but it soaks into, and they're translucent. Like if you want something so you can't see what's below it, you'd use acrylics.
Okay. They also, someone wants to know any advice over getting over the fear of warping. Making it. Yes, I get okay. That. Okay.
So, the reason why I was a spinner for so many years is because the idea of warping a loom was so intimidating, especially in the traditional sense, having to deal with all the patterns, everything, which is so beyond me. One thing that so-called sold me on Saori was the fact that they had pre-wound warps available. That doesn't get you around the actual threading process, which I learned is also very tedious, but the best teacher I had to overcome that was my friend Karen Pardee at Serendipity Studio. And what she did is she just took me through it step by step. And we started with a small narrow warp to learn to enjoy the process. Saori is also the process. It's not just like, you know, great, we can sit down and sit at the black warp and that's it. It's the process. One part I really like doing is making warps. And I've had the privilege of participating in warp exchanges with other members of the wider global Saori community. I believe one of the women that I gave a warp to, she's on this video now, and just recently we reconnected, and she showed me the fabrics that she made. So, and also Denise, the woman, the artist that Juliet had met in New York and introduced to me, she also asked me to create her warps as well, because for some people it's a little bit overwhelming, and when you don't have the spoons, as an artist, you're limited in your spoons in terms of the amount of energy you have to create. And it's always great that I feel like I can alleviate that burden for somebody else and to help them explore and create by creating warps for them.
Right.
I have one thing to add to that, Maureen.
Okay.
When I was having a hard time, you know, setting up these very large pieces took forever and I was very confused and I would mess everything up. And then I'd weave it and it would be a big piece. So it would take me 2 weeks to weave it. And so by the time I went back, I'd forgotten everything. So what I ended up doing was doing tiny, you know, warps that were this wide and were 2 meters deep. And I would go through it super fast, and I would do a different warp like every other day. Not yep. that they weren't without mistakes, but by doing something small and repeating it, it's much less daunting than setting up a 60 meter warp.
It's now past the hour. So I just want to say for people who have to leave, thank you very much for joining us. We appreciate any donations. You can go to our website, www.saoriarts.org. Please follow us on Facebook and Instagram. And we will actually continue this conversation at this point, but I realize I have to respect people's time. So we really appreciate your all coming.